Now, class 9, history. Today, the new chapter, Sangam Age. Sangam Age, cultural and economic contacts between the northern and the southern India. Actually, Sangam means, by any means, Sangam means an assimilation of the culture. Now, look at the book. Though the Aryans had settled down in the north, Aryan culture and civilization gradually infiltrated the south. According to ancient tradition, the Vedic sage Agastya was the first among those who introduced the Aryan customs and ideas into the Dravidian South. That is North and South assimilation. Aryan culture in the North and it mixed with the Dravidian in the South. Later on, many Brahmins, preachers spread the Aryan culture in the South. Sanskrit became popular and Dravidian scholars studied the Vedic literature of the Aryans. The Andhra kingdom was being ruled by Brahmin kings when Mauryas conquered it in the 3rd century BC. During the Mauryan period, many Buddhist and the Jain missionaries came to the southern region. The earliest Sangam texts speak of the river Ganga and the river Son. So that is an assimilation of the culture we observe. Aryan culture made a deep impact on people of the Deccan kingdom. Deccan means in the south, Aryan in the north, Aryan culture made a deep impact on the Deccan kingdoms, but its influence on the people of the deep south was limited. People of the Tamil country had accepted the Brahmanic faith. People of the Tamil country accepted the Brahman faith. But they did not adopt many of the customs of the Aryans. The people of the south, they did not accept many of the culture of the north. They preserved uniqueness of their own culture and the Tamil language was their pride. This helped the Tamil people to retain some of the distinguishing characteristics of the Dravidian civilization till today. Now, these help the Tamil people to retain some of the distinguished Tamil people. They possess some of the distinguishing Dravidian culture till today. Now, just you wait for you think what I taught you still just now. Again, just you wait for a few seconds, my students. Now, look at the book, all of you. For the literary sources, cultural and economic, page number, this is page number B38. I covered B38. Now, look at the book, sources to reconstruct the Sangam Age. Sources to reconstruct the Sangam Age, okay? Now, Tamil is the, look at the book, all of you, Tamil is the, first, the literary sources. You know, we know that in every chapter, sources means literary and the archaeological. Tamil is the oldest language of South India. It possesses a very rich literature. Tamil became the prominent language in the South because of the literary excellence of the Sangam literature. Now, literary, in Sangam literature, very rich in literature. The word Sangam means assembly. That is the assembly. That is where the people assemble together. According to early tradition, three Sangam or assemblies of literary men were held at Madurai, the center of great literary activity in the Tamil country. It is generally accepted that these assemblies lasted from about 1st century BC to the 6th century AD. Many poets, scholars, and bards who gathered there produced a large volume of excellent Tamil poetry. These literary compositions were collected and compiled into books called the Sangam literature. That is the Sangam literature, very important for the literary sources to recollect about the Sangam age. The Tirukkural, the literary works of the third Sangam, constitute the most important part of the Sangam literature, and they are the main source of information about the life and traditions, about the life and traditions of the Tamil people. Tirukkural was written by Tiruvallur. All of you mark it and spell it and practice it in your copy, because spelling is very important. If it is wrong, you will not get any marks. It consisted of 1330 couples organized into 133 chapters. These chapters are grouped into three sections, each dealing with a particular topic, namely Aram, that is Aram means Dharma, Porul, Artha, and Inbam, Kama. Dharma and Kama are obviously related to ethical codes which people were required to follow in their personal life. Artha dealt with business ethics and public affairs. Artha deals with business ethics and public affairs. The scholars viewed this work as having the excellence and features of Sanskrit text, the Dharma Shastras, Artha Shastras, and Kama Sutra. It has been translated into many Indian and European languages. Now, these excellent features of the Sanskrit text, named the Dharma Shastras, the Artha Shastra, and the Kama Sutra. After that, the epics and the other works. These are all the literary sources. That is the Shilapadikaram and the Manimekalam are the two. Mark it, very important, spelling must be careful, are the two famous epics of Tamil literature. The first is regarded as the brightest gem of early Tamil literature. It deals with Kovalam's love for his courtesan called the Madhavi. The other epic, the Manimekalami, deals with the adventures of the daughter born of the union of Kovalam and Madhavi. These epics throw light on the social and economic life of the Tamils up till the 6th century AD. The archaeological sources. After that, the archaeological sources, the megalith. Archaeological sources, the megalith. The word megalith means large stone, mega plus lith. The megalith are found in all. In all upland areas, of the peninsula. Their concentration, however, seemed to be in eastern Andhra and Tamil Nadu. The megalithic culture can be traced from 1000 BC to the early centuries of the Christian era. The megalithic culture is mostly known for its burials. The upland portion of the peninsula were inhabited by people whose graves were called megalith because they were encircled by big pieces of stone. The megalith contained not only skeletons of people who were buried, iron tools, arrows, pottery, and fragments of rice and other grains have also been found. So these are also found. The megalith culture is mostly known for its burials, that is after the death. The upland portion of peninsula were inhabited by people whose graves are called the megalith because they are encircled by the big pieces of the stone. The megalith contained not only skeletons of people who were buried, but they also contain many iron tools, arrows, pottery, and fragments of rice and other grains have also been found. Besides the skeletons of persons buried there, arrowheads, spearheads, and sickles, all made of iron, do show the transition from copper to the Bronze Age culture to the Iron Age. The pottery and agricultural tools within brackets, spearhead, sickles, etc., give us an idea of the culture and sources of livelihood of Megalithic period, of the Megalithic people. After that, the inscriptions. Inscriptions also play very, very important part in to recollect the sources of history. Inscription. The art of writing was known to the Tamils before the beginning of the Christian era. Nearly 80 inscriptions are found. Nearly 80 inscriptions. 80 inscriptions to the, excuse me, students, of the 80 inscriptions in the Brahmi scripts are found, have been found in many caves in the Madurai region. So these are the important inscriptions. These inscriptions belong to the period when the Buddhist and the Jain preachers visited this region. They provide an example of the earliest kind of Tamil, an amazing mixture of the two languages, Tamil and Prakrit. The inscriptions of Karuvela, the ruler of Kalinga, says he destroyed a confederacy of Tamil states, the Tramidesh Sanghatam. So today up till this, that is the inscriptions, the sources of history means literature, very, very careful regarding the spelling. And then after literature, the archaeological sources, megalith, and then the inscriptions. My students, today up till this, and next day the remaining part, and then the another day, okay, a big chapter. Sangam means an assimilation in between the south and the north of India, okay, thank you. In between the Aryan and the Dravidian culture, okay.